Hello, good morning all. This is another question practice session. And so this is the question. Please read the question and understand the question. And from the four options, you can select the correct answer. Before selecting the correct answer, you have to remove or eliminate two negative answers, and then you can select the answers. So let me read the question. A female client is being prepared for surgery. When the nurse asks the client to remove her wedding ring, the client refuses. Which of the following would be the most appropriate response by the nurse? How would you handle this particular situation by the nurse? That is a question. And option number A, encourage the client to use soapy water to remove the ring if it is tight. So in the question, it is not given the ring is tight, so that A can be eliminated, and explain that the hospital cannot be responsible for jewelry worn during the surgery. And the third option is notify the surgeon's office that the surgeon must see the client in the preoperative holding area, which can be considered as a wrong answer. And option number D, tape the ring in place before the client is transported to the preoperative holding area. So what is the answer? So from the options, A and C can be considered as a wrong, and either B or the answer could be D. So what could be the answer? The proper answer is answer D. Tape the ring in place before the client is transported to the preoperative holding area. And next question. The nurse is caring for a client in the pre-anesthesia room. The nurse, not one client who is an older adult, has an increased surgical risk based on which of the following factors? Option number A is decreased kidney functions leading to potential fluid and electrolyte imbalance. Option number B is increased hunger sensation leading to postoperative complication from hyperacidity. Option number C is inability to comprehend the seriousness of surgical intervention leading to non-compliance. Option number D is poor cardiovascular status leading to decreased pain sensation. So from here, first of all, you need to read the question thoroughly and you need to understand the meaning of the question. And here the question, the patient is in the pre-anesthesia room and nurse note that one client who is an older adult has an increased surgical risk based on which of the following risk factors. Option number A is decreased kidney's function leading to potential fluid and electrolyte balance that can be happened. And option number B, increased hunger sensation leading to postoperative complication from hyperacidity. It cannot be considered as a main complicatory factor. So B can be removed. And C, inability to comprehend the seriousness of surgical intervention leading to non-compliance. Even that can also be considered as a wrong thing. And D, poor cardiovascular status. That poor cardiovascular status can be considered as an answer leading to decreased pain sensation. So from the four options, D and C can be eliminated and A and D as the correct answer. From A and D, we cannot select two answers. So better answer from A and D is A. The correct answer for the question is decreased kidney's function leading to potential fluid and electrolyte imbalance. Obviously, after surgery, if the patient's kidney function is not proper or not adequate, it could end up with multiple complications. And the first complication will be fluid and electrolyte imbalance. Gradually, that can end with renal failure. We'll see the next question. A client who takes numerous medication is being prepared for surgery. The nurse reviewing the client medication list is most concerned about which medication that increases the surgical risk. Option number A, an antidiuretic and sedative hypnotics, a corticosteroids and oral hypoglycemic agent. So what could be the answer? I repeat the question. The client who takes numerous medication is being prepared for surgery. Nurse reviewing the client's medication list, and the patient has been taking all of these four medications. So one of these medications causes increased surgical risk. Which one is that? Antidysarrhythmic medications that will only help to reduce or balance the arrhythmias if the patient has. Sedative hypnotics that will cause surgical complications like paralytic ileus or something like that. And corticosteroids as anti-inflammatory medications, and that may suppress the immune system of the body as well as it increases RBS. And oral hypoglycemic agent, that is exactly necessary. So first you need to identify or understand that after surgery, what are the surgical risks? Immediately after surgery, the expected surgical risk is bleeding. That will be expected after 24 to 48 hours after surgery. And next, after the 3 days onwards or after 72 hours, next complication may start, that is infection. And in case of infection, the wound healing will alter. And in case of hyperglycemia, also the delayed wound healing may occur. So these are the certain surgical complications. The main two complications are, one is bleeding and hypovolemia, and the second is infections that will only be expected after 72 hours of surgery. Later, there are other complications like DVT, paralytic ileus, surgery-related psychosis, but those complications are not something related with this medications. So mainly we talk about the medications. Third option, corticosteroid, is the medications which is causing infections or it is causing adrenal suppressions. Okay, any doubts? We'll see the next question. The following client are in the pre-anesthetic holding room. The nurse determines that the client undergoing which procedure is having the most serious or major surgery. Option number A, tonsillectomy, B, biopsy of the breast, arthroscopy, and nephrectomy. Out of these four, major surgery is considered nephrectomy. So the answer is D. This is very simple question. And next question, all of the following client will be having surgery this morning. The nurse concludes that which client is most likely to be at higher surgical risk? A client who has dementia. Option number B, a client who is culturally different than the medical personnel. And C is a client who has mild anxiety. Option number D, a client who has had previous surgery. See, from these four options, you can eliminate two wrong answers. So I think option number C and D can be eliminated because before surgery, majority of the persons will have mild anxiety owing to surgery. And option number D, a client who has had previous surgeries, the patient who has had surgeries in the past, They might be knowing details about surgery, so their surgical risk can be prevented better. So C and D can be eliminated. And from A and B, the proper answer is A. So the correct answer of this question is A. A nurse is preparing a client for surgery. Prior to completing the skin preparation, the nurse assesses the surgical site for which of the following. So here the key is completing the skin preparation. The nurse assessing or assess the surgical site for which of the following. Option number A is presence of pustules or abrasions. Option number B is absence of hair growth. Option number C, presence of lanugo. Option number D is absence of pulsation. So from these two things, you can eliminate two options, that are B can be eliminated and C can also be eliminated. So the answer either could be presence of pustules or abrasions and absence of pulsation. So here the question is completely based on skin preparation. So you need to just think about related with the skin. So the better answer will be presence of pustules or abrasions. Okay. And we'll see the other question. A nurse asks the client about previous surgeries. The client asks the nurse why this information is important. The nurse would explain that previous surgeries can do which of the following. Please go through the options. Option number A, interfere with the absorption of anesthetic agents. Option number B is affect the ability of the client to comprehend the instructions prior to the surgery. As I feel wrong, I'm crossing. And affect the central nervous system. No, I don't feel this is also a correct answer. Affect the client's response to surgery. Yes, if the patient, before surgery, you are asking the client regarding the past surgical history, that will give a complete information regarding the response to the surgery by the patient, as well as how would the patient cooperate with the current situations. So the exact reason why you need to collect the information of past history of surgery is this. So the answer is D here. We'll see the next question. A client who is scheduled for an outpatient surgical procedure arrives at the hospital. During the pre-operative assessment, the nurse smells alcohol on the client's breath. The nurse reports this finding to the surgeon prior to completing the pre-operative assessment. After drawing which conclusion about the significance of this finding? I repeat the question. A client who is scheduled for outpatient surgical procedure, he is in the hospital. During the preoperative assessment, the nurse finds out that the patient smells like alcohol. Nurse reports this information to the surgeon prior to completing the preoperative assessment. Okay. And which of the following options conclude about the significance of this finding? Option number A, alcohol can affect the client's response to anesthesia and surgery, can be considered as an answer. Option number B, alcohol can increase the risk for respiratory complication. Exactly, it is causing GI complications. It is not directly causing any complication related with the respiratory system. So B can be eliminated. Option number C, use of sedatives and hypnotics prior to surgery can decrease the alcohol effect. This is something completely a wrong thing. And D, physiological and psychological response are slowed down by recent alcohol intake. That can also be taken a priority answer. So A can be answer and D can be the answer. B and C is wrong. So we'll see again the options. Option number A, alcohol can affect the client's response to anesthesia and surgery. That can be an answer. And D, physiological and psychological responses are slowed down by recent alcohol intake. So when we compare A and D, the proper or best answer is A. That is, alcohol can affect the client's response to anesthesia and surgery. Okay. Okay, the next question is, a staff nurse is asking questions about the preoperative client's vision and hearing. A family member asks the nurse why these questions are important prior to surgery. What information should the nurse provide as the primary reason for seeking this information? Option number A, this will help us to determine the need for additional resources after discharge. Exactly, this particular option is considered as wrong because this is something giving idea after discharge. Option number B is this will help to assess the risk of accidents in the home after surgery, which could affect the surgical outcome. That can be considered as an answer. Option number C, this helps identify any unanticipated needs prior to beginning the surgery, even that can be removed. And D is, this will help us to individualize how we provide preoperative and postoperative teaching. So the better answer is D. Before surgery or before giving information regarding surgery, you need to identify the language of the patient, understanding of the patient's ability to hear and ability to speak and intellectual ability. Intellectual ability, that doesn't mean that the patient's IQ level. If you are giving simple instructions, whether the patient is able to identify or follow the simple instructions. If the patient is able to identify or follow the instructions, yes, you are providing the information to a correct person. But if the person is not following the information, you have to select another person also to provide the information. Obviously, the patient is the primary one. You have to give the entire information, or you have to make sure that the patient understood the entire informations regarding the surgery. Okay, so this answer, the better answer is D. Next is, a client is admitted for surgery. During the preoperative assessment, the nurse learns the client is taking warfarin sodium. When planning postoperative care for this client, the nurse would include monitoring which of the following? Option number A, delirium tremens. Option number B is respiratory depression. C is bleeding or oozing at the surgical site and hypovolemia. Delirium tremens are not something related with the warfarin, so you can eliminate. Respiratory depression can also be eliminated. So you got now two options, that is bleeding and hypovolemia. Hypovolemia could be complications which are related with bleeding, and directly C is bleeding. See, warfarin is a medicine which causes bleeding. So the direct answer is there in the options. When you compare C and D, the better answer is C. Okay. Next is, while planning postoperative care for an obese client prior to surgery, the nurse would develop which nursing diagnosis specific to the effect of obesity has on post-surgical recovery. The patient is posted for surgery and the patient is obese. And obese patient could end up with a complications like wound evisceration and wound dehiscence. Wound dehiscence is a situations where the wound gapping might occur, and through the gapped wound, the intestine may protrude out, or the internal organs may protrude out through the gapped wound, is called as wound evisceration. These are the two complications which can be expected in a patient after surgery, mainly those patients are obese. Okay, so the option number A is risk for ineffective tissue perfusion, cardiopulmonary can be expected. Option number B, excess fluid volume, that doesn't related with this. And C is a risk for impaired skin integrity or pressure ulcers. We might think that this could be the answer, but that is a wrong thing because here the patient is in postoperative area where postoperative area, postoperative time and obesity, there is a correct relationship regarding the wound gapping as well as the protrusion. Okay, so C can also be removed and the D is ineffective thermoregulation. So from the four options, the correct answer is A, that is a risk for ineffective tissue perfusion, which is related with cardiopulmonary. The post-surgical unit nurse is implementing measures to prevent thrombophlebitis. Which of the following is the priority action by the nurse? Apply ordered anti-embolic stockings. Yes, that can be taken. B is reinforce importance of smoking cessation. Yes, even that can also be good. C, assess the leg with each set of vital signs, which is not directly related. Yes, even that can be kept. D is teach the client to report homan signs. See, all of these four options are something related with thrombophlebitis, that is DVT. But you have to read the question once more. Which of the following is the priority action or the first action by the nurse in order to prevent thrombophlebitis? So in order to prevent DVT or developing DVT, what you need to do is you have to elevate the foot end of the bed and you have to ask the patient to wear anti-embolic stockings. Okay, and unfortunately, if the client develops thrombophlebitis or DVT, the pharmacological management will also help, which are heparin and warfarin. Okay, so here the better or priority action in order to prevent thrombophlebitis is anti-embolic stockings. Any doubts?